Welcome back. Well, there have been new developments into the attempted assassination of Donald Trump. Overnight, the former president's private phone call leaked. And this morning, the Secret Service ramping up security after receiving intel of a separate plot to assassinate him.
For the latest, we're joined by former White House advisor Laura Schwartz, live in Chicago. She does it the Chicago way.
Laura,
hey, Laura. Good evening to you. We heard Trump speak out about the shooting in that private phone call. How about that private conversation, huh?
Well, how about that? It just happened to leak online, and Kennedy just happened to get him to try to court him to support his ticket. Trump did. He said, this would be really good for you. We can do great things together. Kennedy got Trump to talk about the anti-vax stance, and Trump starts going off on how you get, like, these 38 vaccinations, and you put them in a 10-pound baby, and the baby starts to radically change because Kennedy's a huge anti-vaxxer. And then he's talking about the gunshot for the very first time. You know, that they wanted to save for a big interview. That they wanted to save for Trump's moment. So Kennedy's got these three really great nuggets, right? And yesterday, he was just approved to get Secret Service, although he's still like 14% or lower in the polls. He's not on all the ballots. I find it hard to imagine that this was an accident. Because we're talking about Kennedy today.
What's he playing at, though, Laura? I mean, surely it's innocent. Mm-hmm.
Hey, he wants to be a player on the big stage. And he thinks that this just helps him with his anti-vax status. And it helps him with Trump. Yeah, it's a little strategy, I think.
Puzzling. Yeah.
All right. There's some bigger things to talk about in terms of security. The Secret Service are under the pump, and rightly so.
Yeah, you know, they're under the microscope right now, and the Secret Service is briefing some House members behind closed doors. The head of the Oversight Committee requested they come up. I think we'll hear more next week. The head of the Secret Service sat down for an interview for the first time, and we're starting to glean that perhaps this counter-sniper team provided by the local authorities were on the second floor of that building from where the shots came instead of the roof because the roof was sloped. Regardless, there's video coming out showing that, you know, rally goers said, hey, there's somebody on the roof. We see. So it's just getting worse for the Secret Service every day. It's getting worse for them. And so the thing is that independent investigation is going to get underway. It has to come through with not only to discover what failed, but how it won't happen again. But it's just going from bad to worse.
And they've now apparently received intel about some kind of assassination attempt by Iran on the former president.
Yes, and that's something that the State Department confirmed. You know, as they listen in on classified cables, as all countries do with each other, let's face it, they will flag when there either is a plot that they hear rumors that need to be, that want to be set in motion. They obviously know what Trump did during office, which Iranian leaders he sent the kill order for. Same thing with Obama and Osama bin Laden. Same thing with Hillary Clinton. You don't see their bubble ever go down because they will have always been in that room when that decision was made. And those folks, those evil folks, have a long memory and they've got patience. And they will wait it out. That's why it's so important for all of the security services and the State Department, both the eyes and ears on the ground, covert and otherwise across the world and here at home, share that information so they can ramp up security as needed.
Right.
And that is what they did.
Good to see you in Republican red today, Laura.
I'm trying to support the energy of a great political gathering. Democracy at work, no matter what you think.
That's true.
Love your work. Love your work. All right, first up at 7 a.m., Donald Trump has finally spoken out about being shot at that rally on Saturday, but not publicly. Another presidential hopeful leaking a private phone call with the former president.
You know, he's interesting. It was very nice, actually. He called me, and he said, how did you choose to move to the right? I just turned my head to show the chart, and something wrapped me. It felt like a giant, like the world's largest mosquito. And it was. It was a bullet going around.
All right, let's go live to today U.S. correspondent Lauren Tomasi at the Republican National Convention. Lauren, Robert F. Kennedy Jr. has apologized for that leak.
Yeah, apologise profusely, Sarah. Good morning to you, RFK Jr. taking to X, the platform, to apologise to Donald Trump, saying that he was filming with his videographer when he got the phone call from Donald Trump. Of course, so many of the former president's supporters are anxious to hear from the former president himself. But certainly after last night's emotional entrance for Donald Trump, supporters here are more galvanised than ever. When you take a look around, you can see just a sea of red and blue Trump signs every which way you look. The supporters here really unified and the party unified, but all waiting to see when Donald Trump will be back on that stage once again. We know he likes making those unplanned stops, unplanned events. So as to whether the former president will turn out here at the convention today, we'll have to wait and see. But one person who has heard from the president directly is one of his fiercest supporters, a man named Blake. He's often at Donald Trump's rallies wearing a brick suit, the former president often pointing him out. He was at the rally on Saturday when Donald Trump had that assassination attempt on his life, and last night he was front and centre as the former president made his big entrance.
When he came down, he recognized me, he came over to me, extended his arm, you know, across the Secret Service agents to shake my hand. He looked me right in the eye and he said, "That was a hell of a day yesterday, wasn't it?" And I said, "Yes, it was, sir." And the truth is that Donald Trump is a hell of a man, and we're lucky to have him here.
Yeah, there you go, straight from the former president himself. Today is all about Make America Safe Again. That's the theme of today's convention. We'll see a variety of speakers, including Nikki Haley, who was, of course, Donald Trump's fierce competitor in the primary rounds. She was only invited to speak last minute after that assassination attempt, a bit of a show of unity from the Republican Party, as they await for Donald Trump's big speech come Thursday. But we also now know that Donald Trump will hold his first rally since that assassination attempt. That will be on Saturday, and notable, it is inside an arena, and certainly there will be so much security at that rally come Saturday, guys.
Yeah, that's for sure, Lauren. Thank you. Oh, well, with a bandage on his ear and a new running mate at his side, Donald Trump isn't slowing down in his bid for the White House again after surviving an assassination attempt. Former White House advisor Tony Schaefer joins us live now from North Carolina for more. Tony, it's always good to see you. Now, quite the reception, of course, yesterday for Donald Trump at the convention. What a few days he's had.
Oh, indeed. Look, you had the tweet from Conor McGregor. You had the endorsement from Elon Musk. This is a big deal, and he walked in like the boss he is, and I think it was a great reception.
Yeah, it was a hero's reception, that's for sure. We've also, since then, Tony, heard from the president for the first time, too, unofficially, I suppose, about the shooting in that leaked video by Robert F. Kennedy Jr.'s team. Interesting how he was describing what happened.
Yeah, well, look, I've been shot at, but I've not had a bullet through my ear. So I think it's interesting that they're sharing and commiserating. Remember, up until now, this pressure, the Secret Service to finally act to give RFK Jr. a security team, the Secret Service team. So I think that the conversation was very telling, and I think it was good. There's nothing bad within what we've seen.
Well, I guess the only bad thing is that it's a conversation we all want more information on, right? I mean, Donald Trump's take on what happened, that will be worth something to whoever does land that interview eventually. But yesterday was a big day in more ways than one as well. Obviously, Trump has anointed now his running mate in J.D. Vance, a youngster who assures a MAGA future for the Republican Party. But he hasn't always been a fan of Trump. He even once called him America's Hitler. What's going on there?
Yeah, back at 2016, 8 years ago, a lot of things have changed over that time. He became a junior senator. He's actually kind of gone through a metamorphosis, kind of becoming more mature. And I think he recognized that Trump had a lot of the same interests of his personal beliefs at heart. So I think he's become very much a big supporter and friend of the president.
Is the MAGA future assured now for the Republican Party? I mean, there are so many traditional Republicans who just can't stand a lot of the stuff that Trump stands for.
Right.
But J.D. Vance, it seems like a carbon copy of him, just a younger version.
It's a bold choice. And right now, it's hard to completely understand. The party is bifurcated. I'm a Reagan guy. Reagan guys are mostly with Trump. Mm. You got the Bushes and the neocons on the other side. Neocon Nikki, for example, she'll be speaking. And so the future of the party is not decided, but I think it's heavily leaning towards the Trump side.
You know, what's interesting as well, Tony, is the Republican Party obviously seems quite unified at the moment as opposed to what's happening on the opposite side of the aisle. Yeah, so far, as you say. Anything can happen, especially in American politics. But Biden's campaign now, right? I mean, last week, all the focus was on his age. This week, obviously, all the focus has been on the assassination attempt. But how does Biden reassert the narrative here and make this a battle of two men?
So it's a problem. I mean, we kind of make fun of it, but he's got his bent gay finger on the nuclear trigger. And that's not something that makes people comfortable. I reference you to the Lester Holt interview with him. Biden is not changing his tone at all. If you listen carefully, it was a NBC a video interview. He basically, Biden, blames the Republicans for all the vitriol. And it's not true. Mm. He even denied saying the crosshair comment, the bullseye comment. So it's their party is still going to be in disarray. And I don't think they're fully confident that he's the right guy to bring him to November.
Look, a lot's happened in the past few days. A lot more can happen between now and November. Tony, thank you so much for joining us in your insight today.